Open up your Bibles to Ruth. Amen. I love you young girls. You're awesome. So glad you're here at Bible study. Sorry, honey. That's not you anymore. I'm talking about these little teenage girls. Sorry, you're 30. You're an oldster now. It's time for you to take over. Hallelujah. Sorry. Yeah, what's that make me? Praise the Lord. I'm young. I'm still young. Ruth, where are you, Ruth? She's hiding in here. 1 Kings, 2 Kings, Judges, Ruth, Judges, then Ruth, right? I haven't found her yet, but I know she's there. This is what happens when you work on an iPad all the time. Whoa, I think she's there. Joshua, Judges, Ruth. There she is. She's hiding from me. Did you find her? Okay, we're just going to do chapter 1. I'm going to do it fast because I have 23 minutes. Okay, you ready? So, I'm just going to give you a lot of information. I want you to glean what you can. It's fun to study these books of the Bible or these chapters, you know, these individual people that we've been looking at, women. And it's just fun to kind of dig in and, I don't know, do you get something out of doing that? It's so much better than just reading your Bible because you actually get to know these people. Kind of get to know their life, their situations, what they went through, and I love that about that. So the story of Ruth opens up with the phrase, when the judges ruled. Do you see that right there in verse 1? Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled. See that? Oh, we're going to talk about that. Right there. I didn't have to go very far. So what does that mean? It actually means they had no king. The judges were ruling. We just looked at one. What was her name? Deborah. What was her name? Deborah. We just looked at that. She was a judge, right? She was judging the children of Israel. Well, they had been so, you know, disobedient that the kings were, who knows where the kings all were. They all died off or were killed off or something. But it says in those days, in Judges 21:25, it says in those days there was no king in Israel and everyone did what was right in his own eyes. How many of you know that's a problem? There's nobody in leadership. There's nobody directing. Now, the judges were coming up here and there, and when God could get them to obey him and do it like he did Deborah and could get them to follow him and be sensitive to him, he could do what he... Because God had a plan. He's always got a plan. He's got a plan right now. But how many of you know there's a lot of things going on that he has to work around or work with? And he has to find a believer that will listen to him, obey him, and follow his plan to get it to happen. He's not, contrary to what a lot of religions teach, he's not a free agent to just do whatever he wants to do. He has to find people. If he was, everybody be saved. If he was, everybody be healed. If he was, he'd just take us on to heaven. But it's not that way. He needs people that will listen to him, obey him, and do what he has told us to do. Amen? So in these days, there was no king in Israel, and there was, everyone was doing whatever, basically whatever they wanted to do, and you can see that in several different scriptures. The second statement that you see here is there was a famine in the land. Do you see that? Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. Well, why was there a famine in the land? Isn't God the all-provider, the all-sufficient one? What's his name, prayer clinic people? El Shaddai, the all-breasty one, the all-sufficient one. Well, how come there's famine in the land? Right. Who said that? Very good. Right. And so let's look at Judges 2. We'll look at a couple of things here to see why they were in the condition they were in, because it's important that you understand that. Contrary to what a lot of teaching that I've heard that goes on is God was, it's like they put God as the bad guy. God is punishing them. God is inflicting them. God is doing all these terrible things to him, all these terrible things to them. But really, what is the problem here? When I hear that, I hear it like God is inflicting them. In other words, he's commissioning that. He wants bad things to happen to his people. Is that the God that we know? Is that the God of the Bible? No, he's a creator. And sin came in. He's a provider. But sin came in, and when sin came in, it distorted and really destroyed everything. Right? Right. So Judges 2, are you there? Verse 10. We'll start with the verse 10. When all that generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord nor the work which he had done in Israel. Now, isn't that interesting? Somebody didn't do their job. That's why it's so important that we are raising up young people, these young girls, and then our little girls. Did you hear Sydney got saved last night? So her mommy told me she'd been asking her, and she's like, no. Anyway, I don't know the whole story. You can ask her. But anyway, last night she said, Mommy, I'm ready. And Megan went, you ready for what? She goes, I'm ready to get saved. I'm like, glory. Now that's a cool way to get saved, isn't it? 3 years old. So I'm finally ready. I'm ready at 3 years old to get saved. Go, Sydney. And she did. Amen. Now we got to get her filled with the Holy Ghost. That's next. Amen. You got to get saved first, then you get filled. All right, so anyway, they obviously had not been doing what they were supposed to do, was to tell the next generation, raise up the next generation, pour into the next generation, because the next generation came and they don't know anything that's going on, right? That's why you guys are so important, because we're all going to get older and are getting older, and one of these days we're leaving. And it's going to be up to you guys, right? So get all you can while you're young. Don't do the foolish thing and fall off into the, you know, off into the abyss. Stay plugged into God. It's important. Amen. And we'll talk about that in a few minutes. Anyway, so the children of Israel did evil. This is why they did evil, because they didn't know. They did evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals, or the Baals, or the Baals, or whatever his name is, B-A-A-L. I always say that wrong. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers they forsook the Lord and served Baal, I say it right, and Ashtoreth, and the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, so he delivered them into the hands of the plunderers who despoiled them, and he sold them into the hands of their enemies all around, so they could no longer stand before their enemies. The way this is written is like God has commissioned it and ordained it. But what has happened is they have disobeyed. And disobedience brings judgment. That's why it's so, you know, you think of where we're at as a nation right now. It's alarming to me what's happening. I don't know if it alarms you. If you're reading the news and looking at things and reading headlines, it's alarming at what is going on and what is being perpetrated in our nation right now. And if we're not careful, the blessing of God that was in this nation, has been in this nation the whole time, if we're not careful, God just might lift his hand, and guess what we're going to get? We're going to be in trouble. We're already in trouble, because they've already removed they're still removing everything they can that is of God, from monuments to books to everything. You know, it's scary. Just to see where, and it not maybe necessarily for us, but the generations that are to come. What is this nation going to look like to our little ones that are just being born and not even born yet? What kind of nation are they going to live in? What kind of things are they going to have to deal with? That's why it's so important that that's why when we prayed for the children's workers, it's so important that we're putting the word of God in these children as much as we can. Not just at church. It has to be at church, but not just at church, at home. If you've got children at home, don't forsake the putting the word in them for other stupid stuff, like watching whatever stupid things on cartoons. And they need the word of God. They need it planted and rooted in their heart. When you have free time, just be putting that in. Don't set them in front of the TV set and let them just watch garbage. They're getting enough of that at school. I mean, where else are they going to get it if you don't put it in them? You can't depend on the church in the short amount of time that they're here to put it in them. You've got to do it at home. It's so important That your house is a sanctuary where God is, where they learn to pray, they read their Bibles, and they sense God's anointing in His presence. I'm telling you, it's so important. It really is. I'm probably preaching to the choir, but if you put in front of your kids, if all they're filling up on is superheroes and, who's that? Elmo, what's that? Sesame Street. I don't even know if that's still going, right? Or whatever other cartoons that they have, you know, that are cute, but they have these messages that are getting through to your kids that is more powerful than the Word of God in their lives, because they feed off of it all the time. Listen, we have a responsibility. We don't want to raise up a generation that does not know God. And that is exactly where the children of Israel were. Do you see that? And God was fed up with it. So He went, okay, fine. Have it your way. And they started destroying within. They started destroying themselves. It was bad. Leviticus 26 says, after all this, if you do not obey me, then I will punish you 7 times more for your sins. I will break the pride of your power. I'll make your heavens like iron and the earth like bronze, and your knees shall be spent in vain, for the land shall not yield its produce. We're talking about, why was there famine in the land? Here's why, right here. Nor shall the trees of the land yield their fruit. Why? Because they were in disobedience. But it doesn't mean God commissioned it. He told them again and again and again, just obey me. Do what I say. Follow my ways. Follow my will, and everything will be well with you. That's what He said. And He said, when He was in Deuteronomy, He listed all the blessing and then He listed all the curses. I mean, how foolish. How foolish to not just obey. It's not that hard to obey Him. It really isn't. It's not that hard to obey Him. Just do it. Amen? Just do it. You feel like the devil's got a hold of your leg and he's just pulling you and pulling you and pulling you? Kick him off. Ooh, my shoe almost went flying off and hit you. Kick him off and say, let go of me. No, I'm not going that way. I am going God's way. And I'm leading my family God's way. I'm going to seek God every day and find out what His plan is for me, and I'm going to do it. That's when you stay under the shadow of the Almighty and you have blessing in your life. Doesn't mean everything's peachy keen. Doesn't mean that you've got a golden road in front of you. But it does mean that God will shelter you and God will take care of you. Right? But in this case, they just continually disobeyed Him. And they found themselves in problems after problems after problems. And now there's famine in the land. And that is why. God is a provider, and He's provided for you and I. What's He say? Tithe, give. Are you a tither? Are you a giver? If you are, then there's blessing. If you're not, guess what? You're getting the curse. And don't think the curse is better than the blessing. It's not. And you may not see it right now in front of you, but I'm telling you, the curse causeless does not come. Meaning there's curses that are out there for you to get under if you disobey. I don't know why I'm saying that, but anyway, that was for you, because nobody else is here but you. All right. All right, now, let's go back and look. So, I have so much I want to tell you. Okay, so there was a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, and by the way, Bethlehem means this, house of bread. Just note that. Remember that, okay? Bethlehem means house of bread. And there was a certain man who went to dwell in the country of Moab. Moab. He and his wife and his 2 sons, the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife was Naomi, and the names of his 2 sons were Mahlon and Chilion. Aren't those nice names? Anyway, so in the Old Testament, we know that famine was evidence of the curse or the discipline of God for them running away from out from under His covering and not obeying Him, right? Is that clear? Okay. So Elimelech, he's in Bethlehem, and Bethlehem means what? House of bread. So he's in Bethlehem. There's famine in the land. And what he does is he gathers up his family and he goes to Moab. Well, what's so wrong about that? Well, I'll tell you what's so wrong about that. You want to hear? It was in Moab. Moab seduced Israel to idolatry and impurity. Moab hired Balaam. Balaam, remember Balaam? Balak hired Balaam to do what? Do you remember? Curse who? Israel. That was from Moab. Balak was from Moab. And remember when the donkey, you know, he's going down the trail and the donkey stops and he gets all mad and he's kicking the donkey, cussing the donkey out, and the donkey won't move. And all of a sudden God opens his eyes and there's a big old angel standing right there. Do you guys remember that story? And then Balaam's like, oh. Well, first of all, he shouldn't have even been going because God told him not to go. But he, I don't know, he's a magician too, so he's got a little kind of mixed up theology there. And so out he goes, and God was not pleased with that. But anyway, those are the Moabites. The Moabites were wanting, their people were wanting to curse Israel. So they're not friends with Israel. They're enemies of Israel. And so here's Amalek taking his wife and children to the land of Moab. Okay? Also, I found this. Let me see if I can find it. They were worshipers of the god Chemosh, Chemosh, who is a deity whose worship was similar to that of Baal. Okay? So they have foreign gods there. They have all kinds of garbage there. And here's this Israelite, Amalek, taking his wife and his children to this land. Okay? So I don't know why he made this decision, but I would say he was not trusting God. So he's looking for food for his family. And you know, a lot of times we get in a hurry and do things and find out later on, oh, I would have been better off in that land had I stayed. And sometimes we make decisions, we move, we take jobs, we do certain things for whatever reason, pleasure's sake, or we think the grass is greener on the other side. You know, a lot of times people leave church because things get hard or they get a little disruption with the relationship and they think, well, I'm just going to go somewhere else. Well, you know what? Whether you stay or go, you're going to have to deal with the same kind of people wherever you go. Do you not realize that? So just stay put and learn to love everybody and learn to overcome and learn to be strong and don't be flaky. We're jumping from church to church to church because you're unhappy with something somebody did, right? So, you know, I just use that because I see that all the time. But this is what God said about the Moabites in Deuteronomy. He said, an Ammonite or a Moabite shall not enter the assembly of the Lord, even to the 10th generation. None of his descendants shall enter the assembly of the Lord forever because they did not meet you with bread and water on the road when you came out of Egypt, and because they hired against you Balaam the son of Beor to curse you. Okay? So God had told them, don't go hang out with these folks. You young girls, this is what your parents tell you. Don't go hang out with those people. They're not going to be a good influence. Well, God said that to Amalek. Don't hang out there. He knew the laws. He knew what the Torah had said. He knew what God had laid out. But he got his eyes off of God and off of God's word, like we do sometimes. And here he goes. Trekked 50 miles to go to Moab. That's about how far it was from Bethlehem. Bethlehem? Yeah. And so, a lot of times, there's three things. I've got three little points here. When trouble comes into our lives, we make decisions. Okay? We can endure our troubles, our trials. We can escape our troubles or trials. That's what he was doing. Or we can enlist. And enlist means to participate heartily. It means to engage. You know, when you have a trouble or a trial, you can run away from it, you can just endure it, or you can embrace it and say, God, help me, what do I need to learn through this? What do I need to learn through this, Lord? Help me. I can't see this great big mountains in front of me, I can't see around it, but I am going to trust you in this, and I'm not going to run away. And I'm not going to just endure it, because what, you know, anybody can endure it. But no, take that opportunity. There's learning every time you've got a mountain to face, every time you've got a big problem in your face. Take that opportunity to learn from it. I love what James said. Let me run over there real quick. James had a really good teaching about troubles, tribulation, and problems. What did he say? Count it all joy. Don't fall down in the doldrums. Don't run around pouting and getting all upset. No, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith, what's supposed to be working here? Your faith. Your trust in God. Oh, how I wonder if Amalek's family might have had a different outcome if he had trusted God and stayed where God put him instead of running over here to the Moabites. Because you know what happened to him. He died within a 10-year period. Both his sons died after they married Moabite women. One was Ruth, one was Orpah. Two girls, sisters, married two brothers. Chimelon and Hamelon, whatever his name is. Those guys. Okay? So when we have problems, Jesus said this, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. How many of you know we're not going to that's why I said we're not just going to have this yellow brick road that we can walk down and everything's going to be peachy keen in life. It's not. Things happen. You get hurt. You get wounded. You get sick. You get healed. In Jesus' name, every time. Amen. But we are going to have tribulation in this world. But Jesus said, be happy about it. Why? Let's look at it. Be of good cheer is what he said. Be of good cheer. Why? Because I have overcome the world. And I'll just add this. This is Rebecca Sundholm version. And I have put the spirit of overcomer on the inside of you. Tap into that. Don't let this problem get you down. Don't let this problem blow you out of the water. Don't run away from it. Face it. Go after it. Overcome it. Because you've got a winning spirit on the inside of you. And you're going to win this thing. Amen? That's what God says to me. And if he says it to me, he's saying it to you too. Amen? You're going to beat it. Don't listen to the doctor's report. Don't listen to the financial guy who says you're going under. And even if you do go under, God's got something way better on the other side of it. He does. If you keep trusting him and believing in him and you walk by faith and not by, you will win. Yes, you will. Absolutely. The Amplified says it like this, I have told you these things that in me you may have perfect peace and confidence. In the world you will have tribulations and trials and distress and frustration. But frustration, oh my gosh, I was so frustrated today. Oh, I was so frustrated. I don't know what it is. Every time I'm going to teach, something doesn't work. Something just does not work. My computer, my printer, my Dropbox. I mean, I couldn't access anything today. And I had done all my homework. I was all ready, you know, and I can't get it. I can't even send something to Megan because I send her the homework and then she prints it out. I could not get it to her. And I'm like, my husband's in there trying to tell me what to do. And I just want to throw the computer through the roof. I was so frustrated. And all I wanted to do was get here and come pray. That's all I wanted to do. I was like, I just need to go pray. Because right now, we had a very busy day. We went and looked at properties and stuff, and I just needed to go pray. But as soon as I came in here to pray, God's sweet presence just surrounded me, and all those frustrations just went out the door. But I did have a little frustrating afternoon. And sometimes we have those frustrations and things, but if you'll learn to do like what I did, and I knew that on the inside, I just need to go pray. I'll be fine as long as I can go pray. I walked in the door praying. I prayed all the way here in the car. I didn't get here till 5 o'clock. And I messed probably an hour and a half with all these computer things and trying to take, anyway, all that stuff. Anyway, but Jesus said, be of good cheer. Well, you're not going to be in good cheer just of your own emotions. You know what I mean? It's just not going to happen. I was trying. You know, my husband's like, okay, you doing okay? You doing okay? I'm like, no, I'm not doing okay. I want to throw my computer through the roof. Like, every computer I had was blocked up and I couldn't access stuff. It's like, why in the world? Devil, I bind you in Jesus' name. It's just like this little demon goes, oh, good, she's going to go teach tonight. I'm going to have anointing. Okay, here. You know, he's zapping all my stuff, and I'm like, oh. And it worked for a short period of time, not all day. And then Megan did something. It was working tonight. What'd you do to it? Dad did it? Oh, bless his heart. Somebody did it. It was working. I was like, I'm able to get my stuff. Thank you, Jesus. Anyway, praise the Lord. This is what happens when you put everything on computers. Okay, so he says, I have overcome the world. I have deprived it of its power to harm you and have conquered it for you. Darn it, it's after 9. Oh, I've got to get this last part to you. Oh, maybe I should wait. Ah, but you're not going to know how to answer your questions if I don't tell you. Well, maybe you will. You'll figure it out. Anyway, as I didn't even get very far, did I? Okay, so, what do I do? Do you want to go home or you want to go a few more minutes? You okay? All right. Okay, because I want to tell you this. Okay, so then arose, verse 6. So the men die, they all die. So she arose, Naomi, the mother-in-law now, to these two daughters-in-law. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord, son of a gun, had visited his people by giving them bread. Where? In the land of Bethlehem, the house of bread. God showed up there. And evidently, the land of Moab was not all that luscious and great, because now she wants out of there. Everybody dies, the husband dies, her kids die, you know, it's sad. But, and she got bitter. She did. She got bitter through this, but then here she goes, and she's got her two daughters with her, okay? You with me? And they went on their way. So they left. They left. They went on their way to return to the land of Judah. And on the way, now do you see this? So they left. Do you see that? Therefore, she went out from the place where she was, and her two daughter-in-laws were with her, and they went on their way to the return to the land of Judah. And Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, so they must have traveled for a little while, and maybe she's thinking, gosh, what am I doing, dragging these girls with me? I don't have any more sons. Levitical law said that if she had more children, that they should marry than those wives, but she didn't have any more children. So she must have started thinking, okay, well, I don't have any more kids, and I'm getting older, and here I am taking them back into this land, and the land of God, and they should just go back to their land. That's where they're from. That's where they should go. Do you see that? So she says, go, return each to your mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant you that you may find rest, each in the house of her husband. So she kissed them and lifted up their voices. They lifted up their voices and they wept. So they must have really bonded to this mother-in-law, Naomi. She must have been good to them. And they're all, you know, they're all probably experiencing grief. They've lost their husbands and they're all alone and they're all clinging together. And so they said to her, surely we will return with you to your people. But Naomi said, turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Are there still sons in my womb that they might be your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go, for I'm too old to have a husband, and if I should say I have hope, if I should say I have a husband tonight and should also bear sons, would you wait for them until they were grown? In other words, if she had babies, they're going to be babies. Are these girls going to wait until they're grown up and marry them as part of their heritage and their rights? No. She said, no, my daughters, for it grieves me very much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord has gone out from against me. Therefore, they lifted up their voices and wept again. Now, she had kissed them. Did you see that? She had kissed them, and I want to give you a little bit of information about that. When a kiss is given, there is a, a ritual with kissing that's in the Old Testament.
And this voice, this verse points out that the kiss was not a mere expression of emotion, but it constituted a ritual of Naomi breathing onto them. And it was really a breath of her spirit, the spirit of God coming on them as they were going to travel back into the land of Moab, which was not a good land. Do you see that? So it's like a breath that would accompany them as they go back among the idols and the false gods into Moab. But Orpah turned around and kissed her back. And when she did that, she gave back that protection. And what I found, this is what I wanted to share with you. What I found is when Orpah turned around and went back. Sometimes I've seen people that have run away from God do this. She went back into not only, she had come out of that lifestyle of all this stuff that was going on in Moab, but she went back into it and she was 10 times worse than she was before. Okay? So listen to this. She was going back. And let's see, when Orpah did ultimately leave, she gave that kiss back, for she no longer wanted Naomi or her God. She was going back, and it will be for her a new life. Yet what she learned in the house of these Judeans refused to be forgotten. You might say it pursued her. It did not let her sleep. We can only imagine what feelings of frustration, anger, and self-loathing Orpah experienced when she returned to the environment in which she grew up, but to which now she felt foreign because she was married to these Israelites, which now disgusted and revolted her. Yet she could not go back. Her choice was final and could not be undone. To put it differently, she experienced a profound failure. It is not uncommon for people in such situations to feel such an overwhelming sense of defeat, such contempt for what they have done, that they thrust themselves into the very depths of degradation to punish and castigate themselves at the same time as they vainly attempt to assert the rightness of their actions before themselves and others. They go down the bitter cup to its last dregs. That night that Orpah parted from her mother-in-law, she was mixed, had sex with 100 men from 100 nations. And listen to this. She ended up being the ancestor of Goliath. Yes. She ended up leaving Moab and went over to the Philistines. And she had the records that I found in the studies that I did, and this was from a Jewish rabbi and came from that kind of background, that she had 6 illegitimate children. Now Ruth, I'm just going to give you this bit and I'll stop. Ruth, on the other hand, clung to her. Orpah kissed her, gave it the blessing back, and went. Ruth clung to her and said, verse 16, entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go, and wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts you and me. And when Naomi saw, verse 18, when she saw that she was determined to go with her, she stopped speaking to her. Now Ruth, as you will see as we go on in this story, Ruth was the descendant of David. Who did David kill? Isn't that interesting? I'll leave you with that. Father, we thank you for this study tonight. We thank you for just showing us things out of the Word as we study and dig things out. And Father, as these gals do their Bible study this week and next week, I just thank you for enriching them, enlightening them, quickening them, letting them see truth where they need to see it, letting them deal with things in their own hearts that need to be dealt with. And Father, we just loose that anointing over each and every one of them to learn and to grow and to develop to be the godly women that you have called each one of us to be. We thank you for it. I commission them into your hands, Father. I thank you for that the blood of Jesus covers them and surrounds them. I thank you no evil shall befall them. And Father, no harm shall come near their dwellings. I thank you, Father, that your angels watch over each and every one of them as they go travel here to home, from here to home, and then back again. And I thank you, Father, for your blessing on each one of their lives and their families and everyone they come in contact with. In Jesus' name, amen.